Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Judge. Good to be talking with you again. These questions of fairness and who follows the rules and who are the umpires and do we win at all costs or do we respect the traditions of the game are centrally what's before us. So let's get to it with the 20 minutes we have. And thank you again to your family and everyone who's traveled with you today. Judge Barrett, in accepting President Trump's nomination to the Supreme Court, you stated you share the judicial philosophy of Justice Scalia, your mentor, the justice for whom you clerked. His philosophy is, of course, originalism. Essentially, the idea that the authoritative meaning of the Constitution is what it meant when ratified, whether that was 150 years ago, 240 years ago, but meant when ratified. And I think the American people need to better understand what that originalist philosophy could really mean for their everyday lives, because I think it means our entire modern understanding of certain constitutional commitments around liberty, privacy, and equality under the law could in fact be rolled back to 19th or even 18th century understandings in a way unrecognizable to most Americans. Many of these modern notions are rooted in a landmark case decided in 1965, Griswold versus Connecticut, where the Supreme Court held married couples have the right to use contraceptives in the privacy of their own home. In an interview just 8 years ago in 2012 on Fox News, Justice Scalia said this decision was wrong because under his originalist philosophy, there's no such thing as a general right to privacy in the Constitution. This is a question most currently serving justices have answered. When we spoke on the phone last week, you said you couldn't think of any specific issue of law where you disagreed with Justice Scalia. Do you agree with him that Griswold was wrongly decided and thus states should be able to make it illegal to use contraceptives if they so chose?
Well, Senator, as I've said a number of times, I can't express a view, yes or no, A plus or F. In my other capacity, I get to grade, but not in this particular capacity with respect to precedent. I think that Griswold is very, 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 very unlikely to go anywhere. In order for Griswold to be overruled, you or a state legislature would have to pass a law prohibiting the use of birth control, which seems, you know, shockingly unlikely. Right. And then a lower court would have to buck Supreme Court precedent and say, we're not following Griswold. Again, seems very unlikely. So I think that it's an academic question that wouldn't arise, but it's something that I can't opine on, particularly because it does lie at the base of substantive due process doctrine, which is something that continues to be litigated in courts today.
Well, just for the benefit of those watching, Judge Barrett, as I think you well know, your predecessors talked about Griswold in detail. Chief Justice Roberts said he agreed with the Griswold court's conclusion. He shared your view that he's comfortable commenting because it doesn't appear to be an area that would ever come before the court. Justice Alito, Justice Kavanaugh said essentially the same thing, that they'd agreed. In fact, Justice Kagan, who you've been citing on the no grading, said, I do, that she's willing to speak to it. And as every nominee has, I do support the result in Griswold. I understand that you're saying to us you're going to be your own justice and that you're very hesitant to talk about this case because it is an anchor to substantive due process. But let me just one more time say, are you unwilling to say, as so many currently serving justices have, that at least Griswold is not wrong?
I think Griswold isn't going anywhere unless you plan to pass a law prohibiting couples or all people from using birth control. And I think the question, because it's entirely academic, because it seems unthinkable that any legislature would pass such a law, I think the only reason that it's even worth asking that question is to lay a predicate for whether Roe is rightly decided, because Griswold does lie at the foundation of that line of precedent. Right. So because Griswold involves substantive due process, an area that remains one subject to litigation all over the country, I don't think it's an issue, a case that I can opine on, but nor do I think Griswold is in danger of going anywhere.
Well, and to be clear about what it underlies, it's not just that Griswold was a landmark case, as you well know. It anchors a lot of modern liberty interests in personal and family autonomy, It was extended to unmarried couples in Eisenstadt. It was extended to the right for women to control the reproductive choices in Roe and in Casey. But it was also extended to support same-sex couple intimacy in Lawrence v. Texas, and ultimately that same-sex couples have an equal right to marry in Obergefell. The reason I'm taking a few minutes with this is that Justice Scalia publicly disagreed with or dissented in each and every one of these cases. He wrote in one of these decisions that it reflected the court adopting the so-called homosexual agenda. And just last week, Justices Thomas and Alito issued an opinion stating the Supreme Court needs to fix problems from its holding in Obergefell. So I understand you'll be your own justice, and Justice Scalia's philosophy is significant, but I also think you've made it clear that it's largely your philosophy, and I'm trying to help viewers understand what it means to replace a Justice Ginsburg with someone who may more closely follow Justice Scalia's approach. If Justice Scalia had his way, we'd be in a very different country with regards to gender discrimination. In one of Justice Ginsburg's most celebrated decisions in 1996, in the case involving Virginia Military Institute, she struck down their male-only admissions policy. Decades later, VMI honored Justice Ginsburg in recognition of the contributions its female alumni have made. Justice Scalia was the sole dissenter in that case and even accused the court of destroying VMI, which remains standing and strong to this day. Now, I'm just getting at how closely you would ally yourself with Justice Scalia's jurisprudence. Would you agree with Justice Scalia that Justice Ginsburg's decision in VMI was wrong?
Well, Senator Coons, to be clear, as I said, I think in response to this question yesterday, I do share Justice Scalia's approach to text, originalism and textualism. But in the litany of cases that you've just identified, the particular votes that he cast are a different question of whether I would agree with the way that he applied those principles in particular cases. And I've already said, you know, and I hope that you aren't suggesting that I don't have my own mind or that I couldn't think independently or that I would just decide, like, oh, let me see what Justice Scalia has said about this in the past, because I assure you I have my own mind. Everything that he said is not necessarily what I would agree with or what I would do if I were Justice Barrett. That was Justice Scalia. So I share his philosophy, but I've never said that I would always reach the same outcome as he did.
Understood. But I think a case like this is a striking example of what it might mean to replace Justice Ginsburg and her methodology and her approach with someone much closer to Justice Scalia. And frankly, to me, this comes back in part to the president who nominated you. President Trump did not nominate you to carry on Justice Ginsburg's legacy. He nominated you because he wants to undermine or change or shift that legacy. And he's been very clear repeatedly before you were chosen about his intent to nominate justices in the mold of Justice Scalia. You recognized yesterday in an exchange with Senator Leahy that replacing Justice Scalia with Justice Garland, had Judge Garland become Justice Garland, would have changed the balance of the court. It's something you wrote about in 2013 in the Texas Law Review. You recognize these balance shifts are why Supreme Court nominations are so much at issue in presidential elections. Do you just acknowledge that your confirmation, even though you won't be identical to Justice Scalia, will profoundly impact the balance of the court and the way in which it decides future cases?
I think the statement that I was having an interchange with Senator Leahy about yesterday was about an interview that I gave shortly after Justice Scalia's death, but after Judge Garland's nomination. And I did say that, use that phrase, lateral move. And what I meant by that, I mean, I very much agree with Senator Sass that we shouldn't talk about Republican judges and Democratic judges, because I think there are just judges. But of course it's true that judges have differences in judicial philosophy. So I actually think Justice Breyer and Justice Scalia are a great example of this, because they sometimes had public debates with Justice Scalia advocating originalism and Justice Breyer advocating active liberty. And there's room on the court for that, for having different approaches. It's not about having, you know, your colleagues on the other side of the aisle, you know, all of you in the room have different policy platforms, but judges don't have policy platforms. But it is certainly the case that judges take different approaches to interpreting the text. And that is what I meant when I was describing how the balance of the court would shift, it would be away from one balance and toward another in terms of how judges think about the text.
And Judge, what I want to explore with you in the time I have remaining is exactly how those shifts in methodology, in approach, may well have a dramatic impact on the policy outcomes, on what is and isn't upheld as law going forward. On the board behind me, I've asked my team if we would just go back and look at cases. All of these cases listed, it's roughly 120, have something in common. Justice Ginsburg was in the majority, Justice Scalia was in the minority dissenting. And these are cases that touch on nearly every aspect of modern American life. I've talked a lot yesterday about health care and the Affordable Care Act. Yes, that's on there. A number of my colleagues have talked about some other areas. But what's striking is if you just look at what a 5-4 balance towards this methodology means, if changed towards a 5-4 balance to this methodology, it has huge consequences for education, for consumer rights, for access to the courts, for civil rights, for immigration, for environmental protection, for Native American rights, for workers' rights, for elections, for executive power, for reproductive rights, for free speech, civil justice, economic development, privacy, government misconduct, prisoner rights, capital punishment, gun safety, and criminal justice. In each and every one of these cases, if Justice Ginsburg had been replaced by a justice with the same core methodological approach and view of the law and decision making, you can't predict exactly how the case would have turned out, but in virtually every case, it would have moved in a different direction and in a direction much closer to Scalia's philosophy and farther away from Justice Ginsburg. And that's why I think your views on precedent matter, and we should take a few minutes and go through them. It's something you've written about at length and where you're quite well-grounded. The precedents of the court, which is what these 120 cases are precedents upon which litigants, the average American, should be able to rely. And that's that whole issue about whether justices are simply umpires calling balls and strikes or whether there is some agenda. My concern is that a leading scholar in the field of constitutional law has recently reviewed your writings and concluded that you demonstrate an extreme willingness and even radical willingness to revisit settled precedents. Some characterize you as more extreme than Justice Scalia in your approach to precedent and closer to Justice Thomas. The Supreme Court has long held, as you well know, that overturning precedent, a settled case, requires a special justification or strong grounds. But in a 2003 article in the University of Colorado Law Review, you wrote, and I'm quoting, and I think I'll get a chart here in a second that has this quote, "Generally speaking, if a litigant demonstrates a prior decision clearly misinterprets the statutory or constitutional provision it purports to interpret, the court should overrule the precedent." What I see missing from this text and the broader context around it was anything about needing a special justification to overturn settled law or anything about the other factors the Supreme Court typically requires. You seem to be saying a judge should overrule any precedent as long as she thinks it's clearly wrong. If that's your view, and I think from this text it is, it basically means any precedent is at risk where your originalist view of the Constitution or textualist view of the statute says it's clearly wrong. Do you stand by this statement?
Senator Coons, that statement was talking about the courts of appeal. I believe that statement was about the due process clause, and you probably stretch back from your lawyer days, remember the principles of issue preclusion and claim preclusion.
Right.
And that article was about how in the courts of appeals it had a very rigid rule that one panel couldn't overrule another, that those rigid rules in the courts of appeal were inconsistent or in tension with some of the court's issue and claim preclusion doctrine. Mm-hmm. So it wasn't about normal functioning of precedent, especially at the Supreme Court where there are no such rules. And I'll point out that the article was about circuit courts and courts of appeal, and in my time on the Seventh Circuit, I don't think there's any evidence that I've been unwilling to follow or apply circuit precedent. As for this scholar criticizing me as a radical on stare decisis, I'm not sure who it was or the substance of the criticism, but I'm very surprised because I think it was my conversation with Senator Feinstein earlier, I explained that the article which many people have plucked a sentence from, the Texas Law Review article, was a defense of the Supreme Court's approach to constitutional stare decisis.
Let's, if we can, let's move to that quote, because your words weren't just limited to this context, to talking about individual litigants versus how issue preclusion works. It was a novel analysis, the 2003 article, something I hadn't thought of about how stare decisis impacts an individual litigant. But in this 2013 University of Texas Law Review article, which has also been referenced today, you wrote, and I'm quoting, it's more legitimate for a justice to enforce her best understanding of the Constitution rather than a precedent she thinks clearly in conflict with it. Again, you're saying that if a Supreme Court justice thinks a prior ruling was clearly wrong, she should disregard precedent with which she disagrees, regardless of the typical balancing factors.
Senator Coons, with respect, as I explained this morning, that sentence has been plucked out of the article to kind of, I think, create a misimpression about the context. The whole article discussed reliance interests, discussed the reasons for stare decisis, and emphasized that courts ought not disrupt settled precedent, absent very good reason to do so, reliance interests being one. And I think that no one on the court, or even no one in this room, would think that the court ought never revisit its precedent. As I was mentioning, maybe it was to Senator Leahy earlier, you know, Bowers versus Hardwick held that certain sexual conduct between same-sex partners was illegal, it was criminalized, and then Lawrence versus Texas overruled that. And my guess is that you think Lawrence versus Texas was correctly decided, so I don't think, Senator Coons, that your position would be that no precedent should ever be revisited.
Correct. I do think in grievously wrong cases, it is appropriate to reach back, as a number of members have discussed around Brown versus Board and Plessy, and I did note that exchange earlier. But in terms of reliance interests and the significance of reliance interests, in reading that 2003 Colorado Law Review article, you wrote that reliance should count much less, if at all, when a litigant convinces a court that precedent conflicts with the statutory or constitutional provision it purports to interpret. I was struck by that language because I know you choose your words carefully. You've acknowledged reliance interests exist and they're part of the Supreme Court and its approach. But in this article, it seems to me you're giving your own views about whether reliance should matter. And you're unequivocally stating it shouldn't. It should matter less, if at all, when the originalist approach to reading the Constitution says this is wrongly decided. That's why, to me, the concern about reading the Constitution through a Scalia lens rather than a quite different methodologically Ginsburg lens. You've also recognized originalists like yourself are more likely to overturn precedent. In the Texas Law Review article, you cited statistics that self-identified originalists like Scalia and Thomas urged and joined in overruling precedents more than any other justices over an 11-year period. The disturbing picture to me overall about all of this, about precedent, is that I think there's been a movement amongst originalists and a change in terms of the approach of judges to judging who self-identifies originalists. In the 2017 article in the University of Minnesota, in constitutional commentary that's been referenced before, you said, and I'm quoting, about modern originalists, that they've abandoned the claim one should be an originalist because originalism produces more restrained judges. Do you stand by that characterization?
Well, Senator Coons, I just want to point out that in this whole discussion, you know, I did write that Colorado article in 2003. I don't recall that sentence or its context, but in my full body of work, including everything that's come before, including the 2013 Texas Law Review article, I've written at great length about the virtues of stare decisis and the stability interests it serves. And in my scholarship, I've also talked about other features of the judicial system. Right. And also, I'd like to point out that nothing in my record in the Seventh Circuit shows disrespect for stare decisis, and also Justice Scalia did observe and follow precedent. It's not like Justice Scalia ever advocated an overthrow of stare decisis. So I just don't think there's any evidence to suggest that I'm in there trying to burn up the 600 volumes of the United States reports that are on the shelf. I don't have an agenda in that regard.
Well, that's so exactly what caused me concern as I looked at Thomas versus Scalia and which may be more the role model you follow in terms of the application of stare decisis. These quotes jumped off the page. I haven't made a practice of reading 50-page law reviews recently. I don't mean to suggest.
I don't recommend it.
they were compelling and well-written. But these quotes struck me as clear statements of a view or an intent. And as I've said before, the larger challenge here is not what you've said about your views on cases, but what the president who has nominated you has said about his goals and his objectives for your service on the court. And frankly, my concern about originalism and an activist willingness to reconsider precedent is that in combination, Justice Scalia's views, often expressed in sharply worded, memorable dissents, may make for great academic reading, but I think most Americans don't expect them to become the law of the land. And in a long line of cases, they would overturn well-settled precedent that I think we have all come to expect. So my core concern here, Your Honors, that your confirmation may launch a new chapter of conservative judicial activism, unlike anything we've seen in decades. And the point of the chart was to just show we've mostly been talking about the Affordable Care Act and privacy-related cases. But if that's true, it could touch virtually every aspect of modern American life. I pray that I'm wrong. I hope that I am. But in my reading of your work, nothing has alleviated my grave concerns that rather than building on Justice Ginsburg's legacy of advancing privacy and equality and justice, I'm concerned, in fact, you will take the court in a very different direction. And so with all due respect, I will be voting against your confirmation, Your Honor.